Graphics programming is hard. There's so much upfront knowledge you need to have, like linear algebra, low-level programming, inner workings of the GPU, the graphics pipeline, and advanced math for different shader effects. Of course, you can learn all of this on the fly, but most people end up giving up because of how much there is to take in. Also, it really doesn't help that making one single mistake in your calculations results in a black screen or, in the best scenario, a broken model. I spent hours and hours fixing small calculation errors that I made just by not multiplying something in the right order, or forgetting to normalize a value, or silly integer overflow slash memory corruptions, though this last one is mostly because of my language of choice. So to make sure I did understand all of these concepts, I made a software rasterizer, also known as a CPU renderer, as well as my own OpenGL implementation. Okay, so how do we start making our own OpenGL? Ah yes, triangles. To make triangles, we need three coordinates, A, B, and C, each containing two values, X and Y. With that, you can represent any triangle. So first of all, how do we draw a line from A to B, then B to C, and then C to A? Well, let's just take the simplest case. For A, X is equal to 10, and Y is equal to 10. And for B, X is equal to 20, and Y is equal to 10. So, in this case, we can just loop through AX until BX, and we get a straight line. Okay, so far so good. But how about if we have an inclined line? So A stays the same, but BY is now 10 pixels higher. Then we can just grab the difference between AX and BX and call it T. And with that, you have the different Y chords working. This is called parametric linear interpolation, and this is the math behind it, which I will not cover because it's explained better in Tiny Renderer. So just treat it as a black box that let us interpolate through X to Y. Now we have another problem. What if AX is higher than BX? Meaning AX is now 10 pixels more and BX is 10 pixels less. The simplest thing we can do is swap the values, so AX is BX and AY is BY, and the rest of the logic stays the same. The last problem we're gonna face is the case where lines are steep, meaning the difference between AY and BY is higher than AX and BX. You might wonder, why does this happen? Well, remember how we were interpolating through AX to BX? Well, if the difference between these two is, let's say, 4 pixels, then T is gonna change only 4 times when drawing Y, which is alright if the difference between AY and BY is 4 pixels or less, but if it's anything higher, then those pixels are not gonna be drawn, and we're just gonna have 4 pixels for the interpolation. Luckily, the fix is very simple. We can just swap X and Y if the difference between AY and BY is higher. So now we always iterate over the coordinates with most samples. And that's it. Now you create your own draw triangle function, and you have a 3D renderer. You can even draw models like this, with no projection, and draw each of their triangles. Okay, so we're done, right? Well, not exactly. Don't. We still need to fill triangles with textures. How do we do that? In concept, this is also relatively simple. We go through each of the pixels inside of the triangle and check if the point is inside the triangle. If the point is not inside the triangle, then we skip it. For this, we're gonna need barycentric coordinates, which are also explained in Tiny Renderer extensively, but we can treat them as a black box as well. They basically tell you how close to the center you are at a certain pixel of our triangle. We get the values alpha, beta, and gamma, often some up equal to 1, which is the center of the triangle. 0 means that they are at the edge of the triangle, and if they are less than 0, it means that they are outside of the triangle. So we can just check if any of these points is less than 0, and now we know if they are inside or outside the triangle. Barycentric coordinates are essential for rasterization. They allow us to efficiently interpolate through our triangle and make effects like this using their values. For this rainbow triangle, we just multiply RGB with our barycentric coordinates. This works because the closer to each corner, the more they are gonna be of each color. And the closer they get to the center, the wider they are gonna be, forming a rainbow. For a grayscale triangle, we can just get the intensity from A and just multiply all the color values by it. With barycentric coordinates, we can even add textures to models like this, but we can skip this for now. After all of this, a problem you're gonna face when drawing models is that faces of the model that shouldn't be drawn are being drawn, which is definitely not what we want, and is not performant either, since we could just skip the faces that are being covered by others. Here's where we need the Z buffer. The Z buffer is very simple. In our case, it's an array of U8s by the size of our display. In my case, it's static, but you would probably want to allocate it on the heap, depending on the current screen width slash height, so you can resize. At the end of each frame, we have to reset this buffer, which we can do like this. And basically, on each frame drawing, we just check what is the depth we have at the current pixel. Our depth will go from 0 to 255, 0 being the lowest, 255 being the highest. You would do it in another way in a real world app, but it's pretty similar to this. This alone adds 20 FPS more, since we are drawing a lot less pixels in models. But how about we add backface culling, meaning we just draw faces facing us. Then we can just check if total area is less than 0, and if so, skip the triangle. Another optimization we can do is skipping triangles that cover less than 1 pixel, like so. All this added around 10 FPS more to my renderer. Also, here's how front face culling looks like for the curious. If you got here, congrats. That was the hardest part if you had already worked with a 3D graphics library, like OpenGL or Vulkan. Since now, we have our own pipeline. All there is left is projections, matrices, and custom shaders. But those work in the same way as in OpenGL, just on the CPU. So, matrices. If you don't understand these, it's okay, you can also treat them as a black box. But it's what gives everything life. So if you wanna learn them, I recommend 3 blue, 1 brown videos slash blocks. Anyways, matrices help us add projection to our scenes, as well as FOV, render distance, model rotations, and translations, among other things, which are pretty important things we need in our 3D render. Since matrices are very cheap to use in the CPU, and shaders are very expensive because we don't have unlimited threads and have to go through each pixel manually, whenever we can do effects with them, we should. For example, with grass, we can use a shear transformation that moves the grass from left to right over time, instead of a vertex shader. After all of this, it's about using your CPU to its maximum power. So for example, instead of rendering a face at a time in here, you can parallelize this using OpenMP. And the rest is all about creating your own shaders based on existing ones. I made my pipeline very generic, so adding a shader abstraction is possible, and it allows me to create the vertex shader callback and fragment shader callback. But you have to do some weird OOP in C to make it work by passing context and a void pointer, and then changing it to your context struct, but it works well. You could also run all of this in a compute shader in OpenGL, which would improve the performance significantly, but at that point you might as well use their pipeline rather than making your own. All the resources used in this video are in the description. I also streamed all of this on Twitch and YouTube, so if you're interested in tuning in, join my Discord to get notified. Also, for anyone interested in reading the source code, it is YouTube members slash patrons only. I also offer a code review for any C codebase to my patrons, so if you want to support the channel and have access to the code, consider becoming a member. It allows me to focus on making crazier projects without having to worry about sponsors and food. Anyways, big thanks to my only supporter, Minirob, and I hope you guys have a nice day. I'll see you later. Bye.